Can you guys stand to your feet, please?
Stand firm.
Let's stop the conversations. Please lift your hands. We're going to welcome the Holy Spirit.
Wow.
Can you guys just begin to pray in the Spirit? Just pray in the Spirit. We're going to let the Lord open today.
Breathe deep and know I'm holding it all. Sometimes trust in me. Thank you.
every voice, would you sing that I'm desperate for you?
Thank you.
faithful God, faithful God. I know that you would you just lift up your own songs of desperation? Would you lift up your voice? Sing out to Jesus. Cry out to Jesus. Tell him that you need him. Tell him that you're desperate for him. Without you, we can't breathe, God. Without you, we can't breathe. You're here, Jesus. If we could just touch the hem of your robe. If we could just touch the hem of your robe. Songs of desperation, cries of desperation, groans of desperation.
fill the room with incense. Sing a song, sing a song. Fill the room. Keep going.
It's a kingdom, yours. It's a power, yours. It's a glory. Yours is a kingdom.
Keep going, keep going, keep going. going, keep going. Keep going, keep going. Keep going. Keep singing. Raise your hands. Sing to Him. Keep going, keep going. We're not done yet. We're not done yet. Come on, keep going, keep going. Come on, keep going, keep going. Come on, He's here, He's here, He's here. Touch Him, Lord. Touch Him, God. Touch us, Holy Spirit, today again. Oh, we're so thankful, Lord. We're so thankful, Lord. Yes, yes. That's it. Start to build that. Start to build that.
In love you came, gave amazing grace. Thank you for this love, Lord. Thank you for this love. Wash me in your cleansing. thank you for the nail-pierced hands. Wash me in your cleansing blood. Now all I know, your forgiveness and embrace.
Stop looking at the clock. Don't miss the moment. Look at him.
The dawning of heaven crucified. Worthy is
the... You know, the first time we hear of worship in the scriptures, I heard this week, is Genesis. The end of Genesis 22, when the Lord tells Abraham to take Isaac up the mountain. And this form of sacrifice is worship. And when the Lord thought, what could I ask him for that he considers more precious than his own life? He asked for his son. And I think about my sons. They're so much more precious than my own life. I want you to consider the gospel. When the Father thought, I want you to see, close your eyes, I want you to see what he gave up. When the Father thought, what's more precious than me? My son. What could I give up that'll cost me something? You see, Jesus was with him from the beginning. He was the lamb that was slain before the foundation of the world. He'd always had been part of the perichoresis dance of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. The Father said, they're sons and they don't know they're sons. So I'm going to send the most precious thing to me, my son. So when we sing, thank you for the cross, Lord. Remove the callousness of heart, Lord, that has become numb to your cross and numb to the gospel. We renew our love. This weekend has been about renewed vows, renewed love. Please stand up. presence of the Lord is here. Make room at the altar. Some of you have been in church your whole life, and you've never run to the cross. Far away from the cross. Callous in your heart. Callous in your hearts. Or you never picked up your cross to follow after him. Don't miss this moment of renewed love. Not just another proclamation, but one that says, Lord, today I'm going to go home and fall on my face before you and say thank you, Lord, for the cross. If you need to run to the cross, come up front with me. Hurry up. Come on, hurry up. Renewing vows. Run to the cross.
Crown you now with many crowns. You reign victorious. And high and lifted up. Jesus, Son of God.
Pastor James. So you pastor a church close by on Saturday nights, and you come here on Sunday mornings. You lift your hands, stretch your hands towards Pastor James. Oh, Jesus. Lord, I thank you. He's been crying out for an outpouring, Lord. He's been crying out for an outpouring, God. Lord, give him his heart's desires, Lord. Give him his heart's desires, God. Let him see, God, what's in his heart. Let his children see, God, what's in his heart. God, mark that community. Come on, help me pray for him. Mark that community, Lord, with your power. Mark it with your glory, Lord. Let your glory fall, God. Beginning this week in Jesus' mighty name. Beginning this week in Jesus' mighty name. Fill him fresh, Lord. Fill him fresh, God. Fill him, God, with renewed attention. With renewed attention, Lord.
Worthy is the Lamb.
Renewed attention, Lord. Let your glory come, Lord.
Worthy is
fire, God, fire, God. Sing it out, sing it out. Let your glory come, Lord. Let your glory come, Lord. Pastor Mark and Pastor Janine have been with my dad before I was born. Enjoy the fruit of your labor. Enjoy the fruit of your labor. Okay, you guys up front, sorry. Lift your hands. Say, Lord, I come back to the gospel, Lord. Evan Roberts would say, I knew my time was done when I could look at the cross and tears wouldn't fill my eyes. Give us a renewed attention, Lord of Christ, the Lamb that was slain before the foundation of the world. Lord, may this not just be another emotional altar call, but God, transformation that causes this thing to burn in us, that when we're watching TV and wasting time, we hear the gentle whisper of the Lord saying, come away with me. Come away with me. We give you our lives again. We renew our vows. We say, I do this morning. I do. In Jesus' name. And everybody said, amen, amen. Okay, go back to your seats. Just stay with me for a second. Thanks. Do your hands feel okay, Ashley? Your hands bothering you? They're bothering you? Stretch your hands towards Ashley. Father, I thank you right now in Jesus' name that you strengthen her hands, God. Jesus' mighty name. Ashley, you were born for this. You were born for this. I thank you, Lord, that you strengthen her, God. No more pain moving forward in Jesus' mighty name. In Jesus' mighty name. You're going to do this for a long time. And you're going to teach my kids how to do it too. All right. I need my phone. Okay. Hi, guys. It's 12 o'clock. I'm sorry, bro. I'm not sorry. Really quick, we're going to dedicate children unto the Lord today. So if you're a part of that, and I know that we got people in overflow, so I'd like our ushers to be ready. Some of the families that came, I'm not sure they're staying, but I'd like to make sure that we can get as many from overflow in here after the dedications. And just so you know, when we after we pray for your children, is it right away they're going to go out there? And we have a little something for you and your family, and we'll just do all that now, and then we're gonna give. You know, let's give first. Can we give the Lord an offering? Yes. Thanks, Matthew. Can we give the Lord an offering? Yes. How many of you enjoyed this weekend? I walked in yesterday. They're playing Here Comes the Bride. I said, what is happening? And then immediately started crying. Can we honor our worship team? I'm so thankful for them. And I have to, Michelle and Harry, stand up. Listen to me, stand up. Stand up. Honor them. Just honor them. Nope, stand up. No. Want to do a speech? No? No speech? They want hugs. That's right. They love hugs. My sister, Michelle, we would be lost without Michelle. And she worked to make VBS happen with Autumn Joy, to 15 services in 2 weeks, to Habitation. Our team needs like a refreshing from the Lord. And I'm super thankful for my brother and sister. And Lauren Lentz and William Lentz and our production team and Jathan. Can you guys just honor them? So thankful. Came here early this morning to set everything up. There's Lauren. Everyone look at Lauren. Lauren, wave. There's Lauren. We don't know what we'd do without you, Lauren. And Josie. I just love all of you guys. Where's Josie at? She's probably serving, is what she's always doing. Just so thankful for our team. If you are, well, oh yeah, we're giving, I forgot, sorry. I, just give to the Lord, okay? I don't have a speech today, all right? Is that, I don't feel like I shouldn't have to give people a speech that were, you know, revivals happening, and they didn't just look for miracles. They sold lands and brought it to the feet of the apostles. So what if it was just radical enough that, well, the church is whining about money, we're building cities. Amen. Okay, so prepare your hearts, throw that. There it is. Good job, guys. Welcome all of you online people. We love you. How many of you, this is your first time here in this building? Wow. Amen. The rest of our church, I guess they're in overflow. Sorry, guys. Well, welcome. It's a little smaller than the other venue, but we're so happy that you're here. Are you guys already passing the buckets? All right, that was cool. Good job. Give online. Guys, thank you for being faithful. Thank you for allowing us to continue to do this. This is how we build a home together. Amen. Hey, are we going to have an SOH booth here? It's out there? Okay. How many of you are excited about School of Habitation? It's going to be so amazing. Oh, my gosh. You can sign up here. You can do it online. Pastor Jenny will be available, too, if you guys have any questions. But if you are dedicating a baby, would you guys just come up and just fill the altar? And I'm just looking for mom, dad, and baby, okay? If you brought, like, 15 family members, sorry. I understand that. We've got, like, 300. Just come up. This is the first time we're doing this, so. Oh, come here, babe. Yes. You want one?
I said I don't have one yet.
But you want one, don't you? Oh, yeah. We both have baby fever right now. Yeah. Here, come here. Wow, babies. I didn't know if I should, like, dunk them all in water or something. Never done this before, but just flick water. Would you guys stand? Ashley, can you turn it up a little bit? Wait for him over here too, if you guys need. Generational. Thank you, God. Would you guys stretch your hands toward them? Like Hannah, God. Like Hannah. When she said, Lord, I give you this child. Lord, we're asking you, Lord, to do more in our children. To do more in our children, God, than you do in us. Lord, we're asking that 20, 30 years from now, that the glory that they're experiencing, God, is greater than anything we could ever think or imagine. I thank you that this generation Alpha, the first, the new beginning generation, the everything changes generation, we pray, God, that this generation, God, be that Romans 8, creation is groaning for the manifestation of the sons of God. These are they. So we say their name shall be Benjamin, not Benoni, son of favor and power. Would you guys just pray in the spirit? Just pray for them. God, we dedicate them to you. Come on. We dedicate them to you. We dedicate these families to you, Lord. Look at that hair. Oh, my gosh. We give you them, Lord. We give you them. We ask you, God, to use them for your glory. Manifest your presence to them, Lord, at young ages, God. Manifest your presence, Lord, at young ages. God, give them dreams and visions. Dreams and visions, Lord, in Jesus' mighty name. God, may they see your glory. May they see your glory. Come on, pray. Pray for your children. May they see your glory, God. May they see your glory, Lord. God, may our vision, Lord, be too big for it to be accomplished in one generation. So we make a covenant with these kids, God. We make a covenant with these children, Lord, that we will not do it without you. We need you. Lord, may the Levites within them, God, raise up. The priesthood within them, raise up. We dedicate these children of this house, Lord, to you in Jesus' mighty name. And we ask that you shock the world with Generation Alpha. Come on. That you shock the world with Generation Alpha. Shock the world, God. May kingdoms fall, and may they hear in their generation that the kingdoms of this world have become the kingdom of our God and His Christ. In Jesus' mighty name. Oh, and everybody said, amen. Amen. Can you honor them? Can you honor them? Amen. So do they go that way? All right, you can go that way. I was debating if I should like lift them and sing the Lion King song, but. But there's just too many children, too many children. All right. I am so honored. You guys bringing overflow people in now? Is that a thing? But don't take their seats. All right. Eric is a gift from God to me, and I'm selfish about him. He so has impacted my life. I think I've told you this, but December 2017, my whole life changed, and the Lord said to me, you've never built a home with me. I mean, I was seeing people healed, saved. I was seeing all this stuff, you know? I knew how to be a behaved boy, but how many of you know behavior modification is not transformation, right? We need to be pierced by righteousness, right? We don't like become good by doing good things. We are good because He is good. And in 2017, when the Lord said that to me, the Lord led me to two people. He led me to Eric and He led me to my cousin Michael. And I would hear this man minister and weep on stage, and in the simplicity of heart, talk about the love of his bridegroom. And the Lord so changed my life, man. Listening to you. I watched a video one time you did on humility. I thought, I'm the most prideful person in the entire world. I'm gonna get saved again. But this man worships and heaven opens. So now you have to today. But I need you to stand with me. I need you to honor this man of God, Eric Gilmour, as he comes.
Praise God. Well, turn in your Bibles to John 3. I'm not going to go too long. It has been amazing today, has it not? The roof came off this place several times. We worshiped and we were aware of Him. So John 3 is what we're going to look at. But before we read that text, I'm just going to say something over the house. I was in my room, and I was just being with the Lord, you know, quietly attentive, my favorite thing to do on the planet. Just remain quietly attentive, no music, no sounds, except for my wife rustling around in the room a little bit. Just quiet, like this. The internal bend towards the Lord. Just sustaining the sweet sense of His presence, recognizing that in that nothingness is everything. It's like there's no need to do anything, no need to make anything happen. He's the happening. He's the doing. And I just enjoy like this. Attentive. Thank you, Lord. And as I was doing that, the Lord spoke to me for William. And I believe swallowed up in William is the work here. Because the Lord has raised him up for this very thing and the team as well. So in the book of Malachi, there's this interesting statement that the Lord dropped upon me. I don't give words to people. I normally don't ever do that. If I do give you a word, it's probably this. I know exactly what the Lord's saying to you, and it's this. Come to me. I once prophesied to every last person in a gathering because the guy before me was a prophet and he prophesied to everybody personally. So they said to me, will you do the same thing? I said, sure. So I went to each person. I said, I know the word of the Lord for you. Come to me. I went to the next person. I said, the word of the Lord is come to me. I did it to every last person in the place because I know this is something you can bank on Jesus saying every single day of your life. Come to me. Lord, but I'm having an issue right now with my flesh. Come to me. I'm having a problem with my wife. Come to me. I'm having a problem with my finances. Come to me. And no matter what you bring to him, he's saying, bring it to me. And so the Lord dropped this upon me. So I'm saying this is not normal for me, but the Lord came upon me with words. I feel very similar to the language. I can't say it's the same thing, but it felt similar to the prophets. The word of the Lord came to me, or the oracle or the burden of the Lord came upon me, as the prophets would say. And this happened to me, and I saw this phrase here. It says in Malachi, it says, my covenant may continue with Levi, says the Lord. My covenant may continue with Levi. There's a covenant with Levi. And then look at what the covenant is. He says, my covenant with him was one of life and peace. I gave them life and peace to him as an object of worship. So he worshiped me and he stood in awe of my name. True instruction was in his mouth and unrighteousness was not found in his lips. He walked with me in peace and uprightness, and he turned many back from iniquity. For the lips of the priest should preserve knowledge, and men should seek instruction from his mouth, for he is the messenger of the Lord of hosts. But as for you, if you turn aside from these things, he goes on to name some terrible things that happen. If you turn aside from these things, one of which is he will smear the dung of your festivals on your face. This is the symmetry of God. One side, life and peace, dung on your face. So this is, both of these are equally beautiful. But this is what the word of the Lord was for the house. I've called you into the covenant of Levi. A covenant of life and peace. And by life and peace, you will worship the Lord. And you will stand in awe of his name. And this house shall be a house of true instruction. And no unrighteousness shall be named among you in Jesus' name. You will walk in the presence of the Lord, in his peace and his uprightness. And you will turn many back to the Lord in Jesus' name. And your lips, obviously from the top down, will preserve knowledge. And men shall seek instruction from your mouths in Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. For the Lord has called you from the top down as a whole to be a messenger, a sign to this generation. I prophesy this to you with confidence in the name of the Lord Jesus. Hallelujah. John 3, verse 31 is what we're going to look at. Let me pray real quick. Precious Jesus, we worship you and we thank you for your goodness. Oh, your head like snow, your eyes that glow, bronze feet, highest seat, mouth and sword, Christ the Lord, we worship you. And I pray even today, manifest the vibrations of your being into us and program us together with you into synchronization in your precious name. Amen. Amen. So John chapter 3, verse 31, you can see it right there. These are the words of John the Baptist. And this is what I want to emphasize is he who is from above is above all. He who's from above is above all. Charles Spurgeon once wrote, a sermon without Christ at its beginning, middle, and end is a mistake in conception and a crime in execution. He goes on to say, if you leave Christ out, you have left the sun out of the day, the moon out of the night. You have left the waters out of the sea, the floods out of the river. You have left the harvest out of the year, the soul out of the body. You've left joy out of heaven, and you've robbed all of its all. He continues, and he says this. He says, a Christless sermon, you say? This is a brook without water, a cloud without rain, a well which mocks the traveler, a tree twice dead, a sky without sun, a night without a star. It were a realm of death, a place of mourning for angels and laughter for devils. We must preach Jesus Christ. While we were worshiping, I saw like the Lord as a bright light above the whole place, and there was these many veils in front of him, and each veil caused more brightness to come through. As the veils went, more brightness came, and I felt like the Lord was moving veils and causing light to be more pervading throughout the whole place. And I feel like that's what the Lord is doing. I'm ripping veils and dripping blood for 2,000 years just to get to you. That wonderful manifest presence of God, as Tommy Tenney used to say, turns a murderer Saul into a martyr named Paul. There's this incredible power that happens when the eyes behold the Lamb. And this looks like everyday life. This looks like time in his presence. This looks like him being recognized. So Christ is timeless and timely. There will never be a time when Christ is not the most relevant thing. And as a habitation, as a people, Levite people, as a people invited into the covenant with Levi, as that kind of a people, we must preach Jesus Christ. And not just mention him. He must be the source and the center. The biggest mistake is to emphasize streams instead of the source. See, if you focus on streams and not the source, then you'll miss the streams coming from your life. It's the source, Christ, that causes all these other things to happen. He's the source. Everything else is the stream. Praise God. He's the fountain. Everything else is the stream. Praise God. So I challenge every preacher that's within the sound of my voice, every person within the sound of my voice that is having some type of a voice in other people's lives, make everything Jesus. Because it's already that. And if you're not that, then you're outside of what is. Are you following me? God has made everything about Jesus. So if you veer, if you deviate, if you come with Jesus and or not enough of Christ, then you're outside of what God is. Are you understanding what I'm saying? God has locked everything up inside of the man Christ Jesus. So I call out to all of you and even to myself, let us preach Jesus Christ. The apostles were sent around not with cool messages, not with just mere types and shadows of different things. No, they were sent forth with Jesus Christ as their message. Let us be reduced down to one thing, because in that one we have all. There's that story that of that woman who was a Bible teacher for 50 years or so, and at the end of her life she's dying. And she's found on her deathbed and she's saying, I know him in whom I have believed. Her favorite scripture. She's saying it over and over again on the bed. I know him in whom I have believed. I know him in whom I have believed. The pastor comes over and he's listening to her and he says, are you okay? You know, can I pray for you? He prays for her. He comes back a couple days later and she's worse off. And she's lost all of those, that phrase of her favorite verse. I know him in whom I believe. And now she's reduced down to just this. Him. And the pastor looks at her and he recognizes she's lost all of the Bible. But in that one word, she had all of the Bible. him. Praise God. There's a story also of when that famous painting of Jesus standing before Pontius Pilate, it was first painted. It was so famous and it became made such a ruckus that they put it in the newspaper. But in the day that it was actually painted, the newspaper couldn't fit the size of the photograph. So what they did was they put what they could in, and it was only Pilate and his men, no Christ. And this is a type and shadow of what happens with Christianity. A lot of times we include most, but leave out Christ. This is the indictment against the church. We'll tell the story, but not put the emphasis where it belongs, on the man Christ Jesus. He who's from above is above all. The indictment also against the church is just like Mary when she comes to the tomb. She says, they've taken away my Lord and I do not know where they placed him. Most churches you go in and that's the statement you'll come out. They've taken away my Lord and I do not know where they placed him. I mean, if we're preaching and Jesus is not the complete message, if what we're saying is not this man, Jesus Christ, we have shot too low. Because he who's from above is above all. Let it be that Jesus Christ is the very thing that dominates every teaching, every prophetic word, every focus, every proclamation, every bit of preaching that there is, let it be that Jesus dominates everything, because he already does. Praise God, because he who's from above is above all. Praise God. You know, I look at these things and I think about my own life, and I find that I'm constantly trying to clear away the stuff that automatically gets in front of Jesus. And I find that my whole Christian life is just removing things that keep stepping in front of him. So my whole job is just to push stuff out of the way that keeps coming in. Maybe it's the thought of myself, or the thought of my own impact, the thought of my own legacy, the thought of my own name, the what I want to preach, what I think they want to hear. Let's push all this stuff aside and just do what God is doing and thunder from heaven, Jesus Christ, my son, listen to him. Are you following me? I just feel like this is what is most important. And when we say the name Jesus Christ, it's important to remember what we're saying. And sometimes you say Jesus Christ and you don't remember. It's almost as if you don't recall what you're actually saying when you say Jesus Christ. When you say Jesus Christ, you are saying that God has made himself everything I could ever need. You say, Eric, how's that possible? Because the name Jesus means Yeshua, it's salvation, Savior. In other words, this implies you have something to be saved from. This implies that he is the answer for your peril. You have a problem, he's the answer. In his very name, he is the one who saves. And by virtue of the fact that he is Savior, your weaknesses attract him to you. The very name Jesus shows us that you can come and run to him anytime, any place, anywhere, because that's his nature, is to save you, to lift you up, pick you up, and carry you. Jesus, that name, is I've come to save you. But Christ means something specific. You know, in the Old Testament, three types of people were anointed: prophets, priests, and kings. And when you say anointed, it means to be smeared, the oil smeared upon you. And these men are smeared, a king separated for that purpose, a prophet separated for that purpose, a priest separated for that purpose. But Jesus Christ is the smeared one of God. He is the prophet, he is the priest, he is the king. You say, Eric, we know this, but here's how it applies to your life. When you forget that he's king, you start trying to rule your own life and wear the crown on your own head. And when we say Jesus Christ and we worship Jesus Christ, we are proclaiming him as king. Most people's lives are burdened down and weary because they're trying to wear a crown that's too heavy for their heads. You cannot wear a crown made for a god. So take it off your head and put it on the head that it belongs. Listen, let Christ wear the crown he bought with his own blood. That's king. That's king. Now, priest is very important because you can't make it without a priest. You need somebody to stand between you and God. Listen, it's a good thing to remember that you deeply need Jesus. The old Puritans used to pray this: grant me to feel my need of your continual saviorhood. Grant me to feel my need of your continual saviorhood. We need a priest. Someone who stands in our place, stands before us, before God. The scripture says, if anyone sins, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ, the righteous one, the Christ. He is the priest that you need. I've said this many times, but it's one of my favorite quotes. I've just recently become good friends with Dane Ortlund and his incredible book, Gentle and Lowly. I recommend it to everybody. He says this in it. He says, the things about you that make you cringe most make him hug tightest. That's priesthood. Jesus doesn't just meet you in your need. He lives there. That's priesthood. You're going to need me, and here I am. We need also not just a priest. We need the prophet. We need him to be prophet to us. Does that make sense to you? Because how are you going to hear without Jesus? He is God's incredible speaking. And the thing is about this prophet, this priest, this king, all of these wonderful garments that he wears, these facets of his being, they bleed into each other to make the perfect solution to everything in your life. This is in all three of these things merged into each other, bleeding into one another. You have in him everything that could ever be needed in Jesus the Christ, the Savior who is prophet, priest, and king. So let us preach Christ above all things. You see, many things are good for something, but only Christ is good for everything. What I mean by that is, like, bread has a quality about it, and water has a quality about it. Clothes have a quality about it. Medicine has another. But the thing is that they don't bleed into each other. If you're thirsty, eating bread is not going to help you. If you need medicine, clothes are not going to help you. See, they're good for something, but they don't bleed into each other to be perfection. But Jesus Christ is bread for the hungry. He's water for the thirsty. He's clothing for the naked, and he's the physician to the sick. All of his attributes bleed into each other to be the constellation in the sky of everything that you could ever need. He's not just one north star in the sky. He's the entire constellation. Every light that you need, Jesus Christ is. Christ is all. And to look elsewhere is vanity. To look elsewhere itself is unbelief in Jesus the Christ. Are you following me? This is what destroys people's lives. Unbelief in Jesus Christ. They may profess Jesus Christ with their mouth, but to believe that Jesus in Jesus Christ is to receive him as everything. That's why I say to you, to say Jesus Christ is to say God has become everything I could ever need. He is the all-sufficient one. You know, some people believe that El Shaddai means the all-sufficient one. I know it's debated in some circles, but regardless of what you think El Shaddai means, when it's mentioned in Psalm 91, verse 1, when it says, "He who dwells in the secret place of the Most High shall abide under the shadow of El Shaddai." The entire Psalm, Psalm 91, is God providing himself as everything that a man could ever need in Psalm 91. So if El Shaddai means he is the all-sufficient one or not, we see in Psalm 91:1, he shows himself to be that. And the interesting too is that in Genesis 17 and also in Genesis 28, there's two specific instances where El Shaddai is mentioned. The first one is with Abraham. He tells him, "I am El Shaddai," and Abraham's name changes from Abram to Abraham. And then in 28, you see the same thing. God tells Jacob his name is El Shaddai, and when he hears that name, he changes his name from Jacob to Israel. So you see, name changes happen when in a revelation of God being everything that you could ever need. The more we realize Jesus Christ is everything I could ever need, the more transformation will take place in our lives. As a matter of fact, each transformation in your life is one more area in which you recognize he's actually everything I need. I want to be transformed. Keep looking at Jesus, because he'll keep showing you he's everything you need, and that's where the change happens. Praise God. I love that it's that way. So he is a wealth, Christ, and his unrivaled charms. He is a wealth of thought and feeling, praise God. You know, people like to shoot against feelings. Everywhere I go, there's people aiming guns at feelings. But it's like, let me just break it down for you for a second. If I put a Glock 17 in my hand, and I pointed it at your face, and you know that it's not real, you're going to be like this: "Get that out of my face." But if I point a Glock 17 at your face, and you know and believe that it's real, you're going to feel something. Do you understand what I mean? So when you say Jesus Christ, if you don't believe that, you're not going to feel anything. But if you say Jesus Christ and you believe it, you better believe you're going to feel something. Praise God. Praise God. Even in the crackle of the flame, the martyrs sung of his infinite charms. Jesus above all. He's a shepherd for your provision and also a sheep for your pardon. There's nobody like this. I challenge you, as I challenge myself, let's find a way to preach Jesus in every possible way we can. I reach out to you. I lay a red carpet out. I say, come on, let's all walk on this red carpet and try to exhaust the inexhaustible riches of the man, Christ Jesus. Let that be our goal. I'm going to look in this book, and I'm going to try to exhaust everything I can find about how God has one thing on his mind, and it's his son. Praise God. So the prophet carries beautiful words. This Christ carries beautiful words, better than any other prophet by far. What other prophet can say, "Come to me"? all ye who are weary and heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn of me, for I am meek and lowly in heart, and you'll find rest for yourself. What prophet can say that? None. Only Jesus can say that. What other prophet can say, I am the way, I am the truth, I am the life? The prophets would come and they would say, this is the way. Jesus says, I am the way. They were prophets. He's the prophet, praise God. We look at Jesus and we see that he says statements like, do not worry about your life. Who can say this? He says statements like, do not let your heart be troubled. Believe in me. Who else can say things like this? I'm with you always, even until the end of the earth. There's no prophet like Jesus Christ. Praise God. And he's also this great high priest. He's the priest exceeding all other priests after the order of Melchizedek, meaning he never began and he never ends. He holds the priesthood permanently. He's able to save forever all those who approach God through him. Jesus Christ, this priest, he's the Son made perfect forever, exalted above the heavens, holy, innocent, undefiled, separated from sinners, the forerunner who has inaugurated a new and living way to God. There's no prophet like this. There's no priest like this. And there's no king like this. Who else can represent you as the one sentenced for you? I mean, lawyers today, you got to pay them just to represent you. Jesus represents you for free, and he took your punishment already. And he's the King of kings. His throne will last forever. His kingdom shall know no end. Blessed and only sovereign he is, who alone possesses immortality. He dwells in light unapproachable. He holds the government upon his shoulders. Wonderful counselor, mighty God, everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. To the increase of his government, there shall be no end. Praise God, there's no king like Jesus. We need Jesus Christ again and again to show himself as everything we could ever need in the prophet, in the priest, in the king. Oh, if I could just push the door open to his chamber just a little bit, one of his light rays will come out and reduce you down to one desire, which is to gaze upon his beauty, dwelling in his presence forever. Praise God. This is what I'm looking for. This is what I desire above all other things. Jonathan Edwards once wrote, the sight of the beauty of Christ bows the will and draws the heart. So the more you turn your eyes upon Jesus, the more your heart will bow, your will will bow, and your heart will be drawn to him. You say, Eric, I'm just weak in my desire for the Lord. Look upon Jesus Christ. As you look upon Jesus Christ, he will bow your will and he will draw your heart. As Ruth Paxton said, he conquers your will by melting your heart. By seeing him, he just melts the heart away. And then he literally dissolves your ability to resist him by seeing the splendor and majesty that he himself is. See, that sight of him is the source of everything. Everything is sourced in a sight of him, because he's greater than Moses, a greater captain than Joshua. He's a better king than David. He's richer than Solomon. He went higher than Elijah. He's closer to God than Enoch. He's wiser than Daniel. He's more favored than Joseph. He's the stone with seven eyes and the lamb that was slain in your stead. Praise God. You could take each one of those things and expound them forever, because he's greater than the angels and he's higher than the priest, and every knee will bow to his exalted seat. There's seven stars in his hand. Every crown is at his feet. Complete and perfect are his ways. He is the Ancient of Days. The earth and sky flee from his face. He's a person, a taste, a resting place, a refuge for any case. Oh, hasten the day when my faith shall be sight, and because he's bright, my clothes become white. Oh, to look at Jesus and find in him everything you could ever need. Listen, Jacob labored out of love for Rachel. For years, he labored out of love for Rachel. But he pales in comparison to Christ, who has loved you and labored in love for you, waiting for you for so long. There isn't a love. There isn't a bridegroom like him. There isn't anyone who desires you like him. So I say, let's put everything else away and let Jesus be above all, because he's above all people, he's above all things, and he's above all happenings. You say, I've got all this stuff going on in my life. Listen, Jesus Christ is above all because he came down from above. He has lifted everything up out of the earth into the heavens. And this is where I'll close. I told you I didn't want to go too long. You guys are probably warm. Yeah? Praise God. I'm going to close with this. Praise God. We can sit here in the heat and love Jesus. I feel like I'm on a missions trip right now. So I'm going to close with this. This is from C.S. Lewis. How many love C.S. Lewis? Yes, he's really something. A thinker and a worshiper. To mix those two things, you have a concoction that will blow the world up. If you're just a worshiper and you're not a thinker, you're going to have a wonderful life. But if you're a thinker and not a worshiper, you'll probably be able to affect some people in their minds. But if you can mix the two, you're a bomb. Praise God. So, C.S. Lewis says this, we have a problem. The atheist has a problem. And the problem that the atheist comes to is this, is who is Jesus Christ? He's the problem. Here's the reason why. Because his teachings are so moral and so pure and so clean, any thinking man would not fight against them. They're simple. They make sense. They're logical. Doesn't that make sense to you? You think about the practical things Jesus has said. Any thinking moral man would say, that's good. This guy's, he's true. But on the other hand, the claims that Jesus made cause a major problem, because he either is who he says he is, or he is a complete lunatic that makes Hitler look sane. As a matter of fact, what C.S. Lewis says here is he says, Jesus is either God or he's a complete lunatic suffering from the form of delusion, which undermines the whole mind of man. He says, if you think you're an egg, there might be hope for you. But if you think you're God, there's no hope for you. He goes on to say, the claims that Jesus made cause a major problem for anyone who thinks about Jesus. Jesus is that line drawn in the sand. You think about this. Jesus stands up and he's led to his execution and he stands in front of the priest and the priest says to him, who are you? And Jesus says, I am the anointed Son of God, uncreated, and you shall see me appearing at the end of all of history to judge the entire universe. What are you going to do with that? Either he is psychotic or he is God. This is the problem. Jesus Christ is the problem because he's the one you're going to have to bow to. Does that make sense? He goes on to say, he says different interesting statements like, I forgive your sins. Now, who can say I forgive your sins? If somebody stole $5 from William, it would probably be right for William to say, I forgive the guy, we'll speak no more of it. Because that makes sense. But if somebody stole $5 from William and I said, hey, bro, don't worry, I forgive him. That doesn't make any sense because the sin was directly against William. When Jesus goes around saying, I forgive your sins, he claims to be the one that sin is against. Who else can say that? Listen, he's a problem. Jesus Christ is a problem. You're going to have to come face to face with who this man is. And I know you love this kind of talk because you love him. We worshiped him forever. Let's look at these things about him. He goes on and he says this next one. This is insane. He says, he's then on one occasion, this man is looking down on Jerusalem from the hill above it. And suddenly comes an extraordinary remark. I keep on sending you prophets and wise men. And then nobody comments on it. And yet, quite suddenly, almost incidentally, he is claiming to be the power that all through the centuries is sending wise men and leaders into the world. What are you going to do with that statement? This man that we look at and we worship, he sits on that hill and says, I'm the one who sent everybody to you. Praise God. Jesus Christ is a major problem. He goes on to say here, he looks at the disciples and he says, no man need fast when I'm here. He says, who does he think he is that he can tell the school they can have a holiday? Jesus Christ is the problem, because he who's from above is above all. And then he goes on here and he says this. He says, the most incredible statement is when they look at him and they say to him, you're not even 50 years old yet. And Jesus says, before Abraham was, I am. Before Abraham was, Yahweh. Before Abraham was, I am the one who is before all things. I am the Word pre-existent. I'm the one who made all of this, and I'm the one for whom all this was made. I am Jesus the Christ. Can you think of something else to preach? When we have a man like this, when we have a thought like this, when we have the ability to proclaim this, can you think of anything else to preach? No matter how cool it is, it pales when you put it next to Jesus. So this is what I want to end with right here. This statement from C.S. Lewis, it's powerful. He says this, Jesus, like no one else, says things like, come to me, everyone who is carrying a heavy load, and I will set that right. Jesus says, come to me, your sins, all of them, are wiped out. I can do that. Who else can say, I am rebirth, I am life, eat me, drink me, I am your food. And finally, never be afraid, because I've overcome the entire universe. I say all this to say, he who's from above is above all. I issue a call to all of us. Let us reduce our message to one, because in that one, we hit everything that's needed. Jesus Christ is the solution, the universal solution to all the problems of mankind. So you have a friend, you have a family member. Jesus is the answer. I have a problem in my body, I have a problem in my mind. Jesus Christ, he's the answer. I've come to proclaim Christ unto you today, because we preach him so that we might present every man complete and mature on that great day. Paul says, I determined to know nothing except Jesus Christ and him crucified. He tells the Galatians, your problem is this, you're adding to Jesus. He tells the Colossians, Jesus is too low, you need to lift him a little bit higher. He tells the Ephesians, all growth is going to come from this man, Christ Jesus. He tells the Corinthians, this is what you're missing, is Christ crucified. You look at every single letter that Paul writes, he recalls their attention to Jesus Christ, specifically revealed in the gospel. You don't have another message. I don't have another message. This isn't some Jesus movement. This is God's message to the world. And it's always been this way. There isn't certain people that are allowed to preach Jesus. Everybody preaches Christ, and we have nothing else. Are you following me? Nobody can put a monopoly on Jesus. Jesus monopolized everything already. Jesus Christ is the only message, period. So let us resolve together that this is how we will live, looking unto Jesus. And not only how we live, but this is what we will say. We will be like John the Baptist, whose whole life is reduced to this, looking at the Lamb and then calling everyone else to do the same. Praise God. Will you stand with me? Let's just make a vow together as a house. As a house for him. Just put your hand on your heart. And only say this with me if you really believe it in your heart, okay? Say, Jesus, I realize that you are God's message. You're the only solution. Everything is about you. Everything is in you. Everything is for you. You are all, and you are the only. So I bow my knee in covenant with you. I will look to you and live, and I will tell the world of Jesus. I will proclaim him, and I will refuse every distraction, every deviation, every addition. Jesus will be source and center from here on out. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Just right there, just turn your hands up like this and begin to just worship. We're finished, but just praise you, Lord. Yeah, just open your mouth. He's here. Mama, mama, yes, say. forgetting everybody else, just looking up. Oh, you're lovely. Oh, you're lovely. Oh, you're lovely to me. Oh, you're lovely to me. Oh, you're lovely to me. Jesus, I love you. Jesus, I love you. Jesus, I love you. I really do. Oh, your head like snow, your eyes that glow, bronze feet, hyacinth, mouth and sword, Christ the Lord, 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 I worship you. So lovely, none so true. Oh, yeah, I just worship you. I give my heart to you. Take my heart. All my mind, my whole will, I give. You are worthy of it all. You are worthy of it all. For from you are all things, and to you are all things. You deserve the glory. You are worthy of. You are worthy. For from you are all things, and to you are all things. You deserve the glory. Yeah, let's sing it again. You are worthy of it all. You are worthy. For from you are all things, yeah. Hence who you are all things. You deserve the glory. And I exalt thee. I exalt thee. Say you are lovely, because it means he excites love. You are lovely. Oh yes, you are. You
are lovely.
Oh, my heart loves you. My heart loves you. You
are lovely.
You are worthy.
Very softly.
You are worthy. You are worthy. You are worthy. Oh, Lord.
You are worthy. Let's just hum it together.
Colossians 1:15. If we can remember this, if we can remember what Eric spoke and never change the channel, what we currently are experiencing is Him. Sometimes we think, you know, we have to change a channel, we got to move on because we need something fresh. The problem is you stop looking at Him, you added additions to Him. Jesus plus nothing equals everything. Lord, may we remember this as we move into the coming weeks and days. You said everything would change this weekend, and oh, it feels different. May we ever keep this before us, that He is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn of all creation, for by Him all things were created, in heaven and on earth, visible and invisible, whether thrones or dominions or rulers or authorities, all things, everyone say all things, were created through Him and for Him. And He is above all things, and in him all things hold together. He literally holds our bodies together. And He is the head of the body, the church. He is the beginning, the firstborn from the dead, that in everything He might be preeminent. For in him all the fullness of God was pleased to dwell, and through him to reconcile to himself all things, whether on earth or in heaven, making peace by the blood of his cross. Jesus, and you who once were alienated and hostile in your mind, doing evil deeds, he has now, everyone say now, reconciled in the body of the flesh by his death, in order to present you holy and blameless and above reproach. Lord, I thank you that our holiness is because you are holy, that our righteousness is because you, Jesus, are right. So, Lord, we set the seal upon our heart that you are the beginning and the end and everything in between. May we forever be a house for you. We adore your beauty. You're easy to worship. You're easy to love. May we never become bored with you. May we throw away all additions this morning and receive the words of this messenger from heaven, Lord. We honor you. We love you. We give you glory and honor in Jesus' name. And everybody said, amen. Can you guys honor Eric? Wow. Wow. That is the message that the church needs. Can you imagine if that was preached in every pulpit this week? I think fire would fall. That's what I think. I think everybody would look like Luther last night. That bless. There's a calling on you, bro. There's a crazy anointing on your life, my friend. Oh, my. I won't pray for you again, but you step into it. It's time. Man, you preacher of the gospel. Man, that was the Lord that I just made fun of you. The Lord told me to take 2 days and wait on him. So we're not doing anything in the morning or on Tuesday, but I would ask you to join in with me. I'm asking him, what's next? I think the answer is Jesus. But Lord, how can we minister to you and how can we move forward as a family? I feel like he's going to speak something to us. And so I want to invite you as a community, take 48 hours and pray with me about what's next. Can you do that? And as of now, we'll do Wednesday. We'll do Wednesday night at the Way. Well, I think we have childcare now at the Way. Maybe. Did I just say that too soon? Oh, we need you to volunteer. You want childcare? Help. Look at that. People are raising their hand. If you want to volunteer, honestly, who should they talk to? Autumn Joy or Michelle? All right. Guys, I don't want to leave. But it is like 95 in here. You were on a mission trip today. You came here. But this is how this doesn't end. It goes home with you. Amen? So I'll see you guys on Wednesday, but pray with me for 2 days, okay? We believe the Lord is going to give us direction. I love you. I love you. I love you. Have an amazing, amazing week.